Kia ora tātou katoa, welcome to Tagata Pasifika, I'm John Utanga. In August 1965, the Cook Islands became self-governing in free association with New Zealand. Now it's a kind of independence where the Cook Islands are responsible for their own internal affairs, while New Zealand takes care of some foreign matters and defence. Now that was 50 years ago, so just how far has the country come since then? Well, over the next half hour, we'll look at some of the pivotal events in the history of this nation to see just how far they've come.
April 1965, United Nations observers are in the Cook Islands to oversee the country's first election as a self-governing nation.
The UN mission, including representatives from Cuba, Japan and India, was assisted by New Zealand officers from the Department of External Affairs and Island Territories.
New Zealand's been in charge here since the country was annexed in 1901, but now it's handing over the reins to the locals. Preparation for the handover began 2 years earlier.
I think the main thing was there was fear, I think, amongst a lot of us, because the fear of independence was, for us, means severing ties with New Zealand, and therefore our right to go to New Zealand or stay and live in New Zealand would be taken away.
Fears that were reflected by many at the time.
I think the self-government is a bit early for the Cook Island people, because we haven't got the protection to support the island of the Cook Island.
They can't afford self-government. There's no income coming in. The self-government would be conducted here on a very meagre, in a meagre fashion, and they don't have enough to support it.
I don't think these people are really qualified for the job.
Despite the concerns, there was a genuine air of excitement at the time.
Yeah, well, in my last year at Te Reo College in 63, there were a lot of United Nations people around. So it went as far back as 63. There's a lot of movements, activities, and then it started building up.
As the country readied itself for an election, it became clear one man had been preparing for this moment for some years.
Another problem you have to face, Mr. Henry, is that of capable Cook Islanders leaving the islands and going to New Zealand and staying there. What do you mean?
Yes, that is a pity, because quite a lot of good materials have left the island.
Albert Royal Henry had arrived back on Rarotonga some years earlier. He'd been a unionist in New Zealand and had dabbled in several business ventures in Rarotonga. He made an immediate impression.
Polling stations were crowded all day, and it was well into the night before electoral officers, in company with the United Nations observer, began counting the votes.
On election night, the Cook Islands Party, led by Albert Henry, won the majority of seats. However, Albert himself was unable to stand. He had not met residency requirements in time for the election. Instead, his sister stood in a seat until Albert was able to qualify. She resigned and a by-election was held. Albert stood, won, and promptly became the country's first premier.
I think the 10 seats on Rarotonga was won by the Cook Islands Party. Two reasons. One, Albert Henry was a very good speaker. I mean, he was a dynamic speaker. Two, he came at the right time and he led a party against the establishment. And the people just went to that. Finally, the feeling was we now have a say of how our nation should be governed. And that's why I think he was very successful.
I might add that it may go down in history that the opening of the Cook Islands Legislative Assembly is the longest opening in the history of the Commonwealth.
As Albert Henry went about consolidating his power base and running the country, There was no organized opposition at the time, although there were a number of independent MPs who provided a dissenting voice. But as the years passed, there was concern at the Albert Henry style of government.
On the good side, Albert was probably the right person because he had gumption. He was not afraid of the Europeans. Cook Islanders were afraid of Europeans because of 60 years of total control. Albert stood up against them. The sad side is that he also wanted to become king by no one. He wanted to be in charge. No one dare challenge his authority. And that spread down to the family.
His son Tupui is Minister of Social Services. A cousin, Jeff Henry, a former political opponent, is Minister of Finance. Another son of the Premier, Hugh Henry, is head of a government department. Another son is manager of the local newspaper and radio station. Albert Henry's sister is Speaker of the Assembly. A daughter is personal secretary to the Premier. A son-in-law manages the government freezer. Henrys, it seems, are everywhere.
People were sacked when they did not support the party. You're either for us or against us. There was no middle ground. And as a result, a lot of our good people who were not interested in playing the game of politics, they left.
It wasn't until the early 1970s that an official opposition party was formed. The independent MPs in Parliament at the time decided to join other concerned Cook Islanders and formed a Democratic Party to lead them. They called upon the services of Tom Davis, a Cook Islands doctor who had been living in the United States for the last 17 years. He had impeccable credentials, having worked as a medical officer in the islands and on the space program in the US.
The feeling was you needed someone like that with the aura of power in order to match the Albert Henry power in the political sense. And so they brought Papa Tom.
I think our people are well educated, always have been, thanks perhaps to New Zealand.
Despite his return to the Cook Islands, Dr. Davis was unable to make big inroads into the Cook Islands Party power base. By now, the Cook Islands was well and truly on its way to joining the rest of the world, with the construction of an international airport, and a large hotel development was on its way. In 1974 came the opening of the airport.
This airport promises to be a stepping stone in our journey to economic self-sufficiency.
And a royal visit to confer on Premier Albert Henry a knighthood.
He's a man that deserved that the things that he did. See, with the planning of tourism was one of them there. And he saw that the country could not survive on agriculture alone. They had something else. And so he was in the plan, the whole economic, total economic plan was tourism. And the international airport was pivotal to that development.
When we come back, it's 1978, and an election scandal brings down the government of Sir Albert's Royal Henry. Rarotonga 2015, the local market is a mecca for visitors and Cook Islanders alike. Tourism is very much the country's main income earner. But in the early 1970s, tourism was very much in its infancy. In fact, one of the biggest concerns at the time was not the influx of visitors, but the exodus of Cook Islanders to New Zealand.
I think one of the main reasons is that over the last two or three years, a lot of the young people are disappointed. There's so many promises, or what they feel, there are so many things coming up which they could involve themselves in, for example, the hotel. And it appears that the only thing that has come up, in fact, is the airport. They've been working on the airport, and as there is nothing else after the airport, next step is New Zealand.
Of course, the exodus got worse when the international airport was opened, but that wasn't the only problem facing Yawata Short in that period.
As a young lawyer, gosh, a lot of my court cases were against government for wrongful dismissal. I mean, I remember one case where there was about 45 employees in public works they were all dismissed or made redundant. But when I took the thing to court, and when we went through the hearings, it was quite clear that the reason they were sent home was the fact that they were caught at a Democratic or an opposition party meeting.
Campaign open.
Leading up to the 1978 election, it became clear it would be a tightly fought affair. The Democratic Party were keen to hatch a plan it had unsuccessfully tried in a previous election to bring Cook Islanders back from New Zealand to vote.
If you're a Cook Islander, you're allowed to vote. There's no restrictions about how long you've been away. So we figured that flying electors to Rarotonga was the answer. 74, the benchmark was set. But I think they had a small aircraft with barely 50 people on it. The idea was there, but as I said, there wasn't enough.
Newly knighted, Sir Albert Henry went on the offensive when he heard the opposition were planning to fly in voters from New Zealand.
Towards the 78 election, the Democratic Party was becoming stronger. People were starting to leave the Cook Islands Party and moving towards the Democratic Party. We knew that.
The Cook Islands Party chartered 6 aircraft to fly voters from New Zealand. Voters were asked to pay a nominal fee, but the bulk of costs were supposedly met by the party.
I thought it was a perfect plan. Then when we finally presented to the old man, he was so excited by the whole thing, with possibility that Tom will lose his seat.
Each flight was met at the airport by Sir Albert with much fanfare before passengers were ushered in to vote and promptly put back on the plane. It was a unique election, to say the least.
We knew we were in trouble as soon as Albert and the government announced that they had chartered 6 planes to fly in voters from New Zealand and bragged the fact that their voters did not have to pay for their airfares. We kept saying, nah, there's no way he's going to get the money. No way. And then when the planes arrived, we were winning, in my view.
When the votes were counted, Sir Albert came out a clear winner, but it was a short-lived victory. The fly-in voter system drew strong protests from the opposition party, and eventually this led to a major investigation by the country's Chief Justice, Mr. Don.
Now, I was on the outside, you know, with all the local lawyers. We were actually being harassed by the government. The people in Treasury, no one gave us any information, any help. Government was being run by the crooks.
Finally, 4 months after the original elections, Mr. Justice Don delivered his decision. He found that there was unlawful conduct of monumental dimensions and ample evidence of corrupt or criminal intention. He also concluded that Sir Albert's charter flights had been unlawfully paid out of public funds, a clear breach of the Public Moneys Act. Mr. Don disallowed all the votes cast by the Cook Islands Party fly-in voters. This gave Dr. Tom Davis the necessary number of seats to form a government. The decision was unprecedented in the electoral history of the Commonwealth. Only hours after it was delivered, Dr. Tom Davis was sworn in as the new Premier of the Cook Islands.
I took the decision calmly, although, in my own personal opinion, you look in my eye and see if you can interpret it. My thinking. I cannot say it out because I'd probably be accused or prosecuted for saying what I think.
Despite his bravado, Sir Albert had been found guilty of electoral fraud. He also admitted 2 charges of conspiracy and 1 of corruption. He received a fine, probation, and was barred from ever having anything to do with politics. But worse was to come.
When they stripped him of his knighthood, I thought it was wrong. And I thought that was in itself injustice. He deserved it. It was his. It was given to him by the Queen. And the court did not have the right to take away from him. I thought it was wrong, and I made it known too. And I made it known to Tom Davis and Yaweta.
We were angry in cabinet because we were not informed of it. So we don't know who made the recommendation, but obviously it would have come from New Zealand. There was no need for it. I would have preferred to see him either pay a fine or something like that and kept his knighthood. To me, the loss of his knighthood was a loss for all of us. It certainly was not, as a lot of people tend to think, it was our decision. No way. We didn't know about it. If it came to cabinet, I don't think any of us would have recommended it. I think he had suffered enough. That was our view at the time.
Albert Henry never quite recovered from the disappointment of his fall from grace. He died from illness just over a year later in January 1981. When we come back, Tom Davis takes the reins and another Henry takes control of the Cook Islands Party. In the aftermath of the 1978 elections and subsequent court case, the Democratic Party were in charge under the leadership of Dr. Tom Davis. One of the first things he did was to change the country's flag to reflect its links with the Commonwealth.
Any political party, any faction, can look at and say, there is no politics in this at all, it is our flag, and it is one we will pay allegiance to.
The green and gold version seen as an emblem for the defeated Cook Islands Party. There were also many other issues to deal with.
Having won the election, all our supporters now wanted us to revenge. That was the hardest part. They wanted us to do what the CIPs did to them. And that was what we did not want to do. Otherwise, you will just perpetuate, you know, the Mugabe situation. And so immediately, within 6 months, we had a conference called, and our supporters got stuck into us. That was one of those times I was happy to hide behind Tom Davis. And we also had a problem with the economy. The economy was falling apart. There was no economy. So Tom was the architect of the changes that we had. You know, we liberalized the economy, allowed people with the ability to do whatever they want. And so long as within the law, we supported them.
Despite his obvious leadership qualities, Dr. Davis did not have it all his own way. In 1983, he suffered a defeat when Geoffrey Henry, leader of the Cook Islands Party, became Prime Minister, but it was short-lived. Internal wranglings within the CIP resulted in a confidence vote, which Henry lost. Once again, Dr. Davis was in charge.
We had a lot of robust discussions on how what he's doing, and I see where he's focusing on privatizing, you know, people going into private business and not just relying on a government job to sustain yourself. And I understand our GDP for the first time was one of the best in the world. Suddenly Cook Islanders were in business, over 1,000 businesses recorded, but Tom has some weaknesses.
Those weaknesses led to Dr. Davis being ousted by his own party in 1987.
Sir Thomas was not in Parliament today when the motion of no confidence was proposed in himself and his cabinet. They've been wrangling behind the scenes over his budget since last week. It was used as the excuse to oust him.
Deputy leader Dr. Pupuga Robati assumed the prime ministership. 2 years later, the Democrats were out and Geoffrey Henry became prime minister.
I was very close to him, and I worked very closely with him. He was a very, very articulate person. He had some really strong points that unfortunately I don't think, he had the opportunity enough to flourish.
Under Geoff Henry's leadership, the country embarked on an ambitious spending program, particularly on cultural projects, the Prime Minister borrowing millions to realise his vision. At the same time, Henry inherited huge debts racked up by the previous government.
Reflecting on the loans he has had dealings with Prime Minister Geoffrey Henry says he has no doubt they will be repaid.
Don't forget, I didn't structure this loan. I've got the problem and I'm going to deal with it the best way we can.
By the mid-1990s, the country was broke and drastic measures had to be taken. Government services were sold off, overseas offices closed, and public service workers laid off.
I went through those cuts, you know, public servants reduced, over 2,000 public servants were made redundant, and they had no choice but to get on a plane and look for jobs elsewhere.
The more we work together, the shorter this time of distress will last. The more we work together, the greater will be the benefits as we cross this national Rubicon.
The 1996 reforms was a slash and burn case where we had a guy from New Zealand who came in and basically chopped away at all of the entities of government that was costing money and just chopped, got rid of the Rarotonga, got rid of a whole lot of things.
Many of those who lost jobs left the country. It signalled the end of Geoffrey Henry's political career. Those who look back on that period admit it was probably for the best.
If anything, it sort of gave us a wake-up call that there is another way of living and enjoying our paradise instead of just being brought up with this idea that if you want to, to be somebody in the Cook Islands, you've got to work for government. And it was the only option. So that period in our history actually opened our eyes to the potential and the possibilities.
By the end of the decade, further party infighting led to numerous leadership changes until about the mid-2000s, when unlikely Prime Minister Jim Marure held power long enough for a stable administration to emerge. Today, incumbent Prime Minister Henry Puna leads a government with a very slim majority in a country vastly different 5 decades on.
The biggest challenge that I see is coming up with some initiatives that will ensure that our people can sustain the current lifestyle that we have and the future lifestyle that we want for our children.
As the country embarks on a celebration of 50 years of self-government, those who've been at the centre of it all take stock.
Fantastic. I would say 50 years of success, 50 years of freedom and advancement. Knowing you are your own boss.
We need far-reaching leadership with a vision for the future and have the courage and the strength to carry it through.
Ko ore e di mongon mentai si ito pa kini agara ngawe e ten ni tatu mo ara tatu e ene ni mo rinwa tu e ko ere de ta ipe e tatu de ro mai ere te ro ngai no mai ya ko mite ki ta to ite tu ai o ako mite ki te tu ita tu no mai ta to ite hutu tu anga to ta to pasre ya.
There you have it, 50 years of self-government in the Cook Islands. Next week we return to our regular programming. Until then, have a great week. Kia rana e kia manuia.
People love the sun, to our new homebound, Tangata Pasifika, born a people proud. People of the sun, people.